Hey guys, this is Keenan Fry and you're watching the Acid Drip. So I want to start off by pulling in this tab real quick. I got a message from this guy. Come on up. This is Miguel Galindo. And that's my Acid Drip page. Yeah. So Miguel shot me a message asking me to analyze the Benediction cover. So he's like, oh, I watched your Dan Seagrave video. And he wanted me to talk about Transcend the Rubicon. So Miguel, this video goes out to you. Thanks for reaching out to me. So I like to make a point of connecting with the people who reach out to me through social media or whatever. If you do reach out to me, I will respond to you. And if you have a request and it's within a fair amount of reason, I will get back to you. So actually, this is the second video I've now recorded on Benediction's Transcend the Rubicon. I did a previous video, but I didn't publish it or edit it because there were a lot of problems. First off, my Adobe Creative Cloud crashed while recording the last video three times. This computer is fucking freezing. Look at this shit. Thank you. Preparing security options and fuck. Why is this shit freezing? There's literally nothing. I need a better computer. Crash report. My life. This is my life. Why? Zoom out. Don't. It just froze. And it froze again. This is doomed. This is doomed. This is doomed. Why? What bullshit is it? Oh, it crashed. Oh, I'm so surprised it crashed. Oh my God. And I lost most of my lines each time it crashed. I mean, a bunch of them uploaded, about half of them uploaded, but each time I was like rebuilding the design, which is really frustrating. So there was a lot of cussing in that video. but in this one, less so. So I want to start off by showing you the guides. I started off actually framing it in a by a 4x4, but I ended up deleting those 4x4 guides and just going with what I'm showing you here, which were mostly vertical guides. I'm gonna turn them off now, and I'm gonna start off by kind of giving you some information about just what we're talking about here, this album cover. So first off, the phrase Rubicon, Transcend the Rubicon, is a ancient Roman phrase, and it has to do with Julius Caesar. And there is a small river in Italy that is just outside of the city of Rome. And Roman law dictated that you could not bring your military, your personal military, into the city of Rome. It was done that way so that people couldn't orchestrate coups. So Julius Caesar, before he actually became Julius Caesar, had his military outside of the Rubicon, and he famously said, "The die is cast, transcend the Rubicon. We must transcend the Rubicon." And it basically means to overcome the boundary. So basically, Julius Caesar says, "Let's transcend the Rubicon," and then he goes into Rome, kills a bunch of people, and orchestrates a coup and basically becomes the Caesar of Rome, and is the first emperor of Rome. And that's where the term Caesar comes from. That's where all of it comes from. So Rubicon is literally a river. It's referring to a river, and it's also referring to a barrier, like overcoming a barrier. So it's this ancient sort of concept And then in addition to that, it has some Catholic implications because, again, this is Italy, which is also the home of Roman Catholicism. So later on, it came to have like a religious meaning. And, you know, for the whole construction of Christianity and such, it's one of those forces that in society has often been rebelled against, especially by the genre of heavy metal. And what we can obviously see here for the Benediction cover is what looks to be a nun holding a cross and some kind of demonic creature holding an upside down cross. So the title Benediction in and of itself has Christian references, but the phrase Transcend the Rubicon in itself has Roman and Christian heritage. And then in and of itself, there is a river. Obviously, there is a big river in the middle of this piece. So thematically, that ties in a lot of stuff. So with the background kind of knocked out and some of the history, let's talk about the graphics of this. So for starters, this piece is really difficult to analyze because there's a lot going on. In my other video about Dan Seagrave, there's really like one entity in the foreground and then a lot of really simple geometric shapes. I did a video on this Trivium artwork that he did, and it's an angel standing on a plinth, and then there's a bunch of weird tombstones jutting out of the ground, and the tombstones are really warped, but the main point of perspective is the angel's, it would be my front right leg, but in the picture it's the angel's front left. So what does any of this mean? What does any of this mean? Well, in the other one, because there's one main focal point and then a bunch of very simple objects jutting off in weird directions, it's really easy to kind of just go to that focal point subconsciously. And there's a character, and that character is this angel statue thing, but the angel actually looks like it's alive. It doesn't look like a statue. In this piece, the focal point is somewhere around this area of the statue, like his ankles and his seating position. It's actually a little bit below his head and chest. It's like right around here. There's a lot of lines of intersection around here, and you can see what I've laid out. So the focal point isn't actually his face, but his face is like right above it, which is a good thing because if all the ley lines of perspective aligned and then his head was right where those points aligned, it would just look kind of weird. So you always find your focal point in the piece and then like the main conceptual piece, which is a face, you know, or something of those of that nature, you skew it a little bit off. It's like when you take a photograph and instead of framing everything dead center, you know, make it a little skewed, a little bit off to the side of the frame, because if everything's just dead centered, it's just so straight ahead and in front of you, you can't really appreciate it. Actually having a little bit of negative space to one side and a little bit less negative space on the other side actually creates a good sense of rhythm and balance. Even if you would normally think that, you know, having equal distance, like right here in this camera, like my head is pretty much center in this, right? There's this equal amount over here and there's an equal amount over here, right? So you would think that creates balance, but really it just creates a very neutral photo or picture. And in that process, it creates something that's very stale and static and it looks petrified. Whereas if it's like leaning to one side or the other side, it creates a little bit more dynamicism. So here, I would say the focal point is somewhere in this area of his chest, actually, and his head is right above it. I wouldn't be surprised if there's a lot of points of intersection going through his legs and going through his chest itself, and his head is on the same line going through the chest, which would, as a plane, bisect the character in half, basically directly from his head through his crotch, like I'll try to vaguely do it. Well, actually, no, I shouldn't use a guide to do that. I should do it this way. Believe there would be a point somewhere like so through the center of him, and it would be at a diagonal, and then I want to make that point white. It'd probably be something like this. Something like that would probably be really close to like the center of the character, and yeah, that looks about right. Through the middle of the tongue, through the center of his chest, those are his two nipples, directly in the middle. It's pretty much bilaterally symmetrical. And that's where I would say it's at. So somewhere around there. And then what you could do, if you really wanted to keep analyzing this, I've already spent a lot of time on this, so I'm going to try and make this process not necessarily quick, but more focused. I made the initial video, which was something like 2 hours long when I first made this, partly because of all the crashing that happened to my computer. So now, with the lion's share of the analysis done, I want to try and keep this as on point as possible. So then I would say okay. So now that we've kind of created this little triangle, which is showing us the plane in between his two legs, which is basically the space that he's not sitting on and is the top of its chair, this plane should be parallel to this one. And it roughly looks like it is. The way you would be able to tell is, see how the line is purple? That implies that it's a line extension. It has to line extend to this guy right here and intersect there. And then if this is correct, it will continue to line extend, and boom, yeah, there it is. So now what we would say is that that's at a much higher plane than down here. So when I align these together, it's really hard to explain this, because it's like a really, really difficult thing to look at. I'm gonna move it back to where it was and just make it much simpler. Move it a little bit more forward, like so. Okay, so what's the best way to explain this? Okay, the statue figure is sitting in a chair. And a chair has four legs that sits flat on a plane. And so here are the legs sitting flat on the plane. The seat of the chair where the character is sitting is also going to be parallel to the ground. That's just how that works. But in terms of perspective, it's actually slightly skew. And that's because the Earth is round. And if everything was perfectly flat, our world would physically not function. But if everything was physically flat, all horizon lines and perspective lines would pretty much never intersect. So it's a really profound thing to realize that there are intersection points, because it intrinsically challenges the concept that the Earth is flat. This is something that was discovered in the Renaissance Age, like the understanding of three-point perspective. It was really developed during the Renaissance Age. And the ironic nature of that is, during that era, the church still believed that the Earth was flat. A lot of people still believed that the Earth was flat, when it was, in fact, round. And you could, with just the principles of drawing and looking at vanishing points, realize that the Earth is round because it's turning away from you. How this plays into the picture is that, obviously, if all perspective is based off of the concept that the Earth is round, when you draw something in perspective, you have to acknowledge this. And part of that is that if you have an object that is, in fact, turning, there is an incremental amount of change. And when you are at a distance, you can perceive that change. When you're up close to something, you don't perceive the warp of the Earth. But here, I'll show you something funny that will crack you guys up. So this is my Facebook profile. Please don't spam me or harass me. But this is my photo from skydiving. Come on, open up. This is a small personal anecdote, if I can get the stinking thing to come up. No, I don't want to edit my photo. No, just show me the photo. God. I hate Facebook. Facebook is a dumpster fire. Okay, so that's me skydiving. Now, here's the thing about skydiving. When you're high enough up, like I was, you look down at the earth and you can see the curvature of the earth because you're so far away from the earth. And normally when you look at the earth, you're on ground level with the earth. Even if you're on a really high mountain, you still don't really see the curvature of the earth. You have to be really, really, really high up, like ridiculously high up, to really see like the earth bend around you. It's really bizarre. And when I was that high up skydiving, I looked down at this pool of water. We were in Lodi near Davis, California, and there was a lake and it was bent. It was bent. Now that's the weirdest thing to think about because you're so high up, you can see water bending. It's conceptually weird because when you look at water, if you were to example, have a countertop, like a marble countertop, and you were to just pour water onto the countertop, it would lay flat on the counter. And you would look at it and you wouldn't say that counter is round, but it actually kind of is in a weirdly conceptual sense because it is round in terms of perspective. It is bending at a certain amount of distance. It will look like that. And when you look at water laying on the earth, when you look at water from ground level, it's like it's flat. But when you're up in the air looking down at it, you can see the curvature of the earth. You can see it. It's like a giant fisheye. Everything just warps. And you can see the roundness of the earth, which is, it's a really weird thing to think about, but it's actually there. So everything curves, which means everything can turn into itself. Everything vanishes. This is a weird thing to think about. And the further you go out, the more you can see it. So to demonstrate that in this piece, we have a series of roughly, seemingly parallel lines that aren't actually parallel. So this bottom line represents the ending of the bridge and the starting of this doorway. This top line is in alignment with the shelf edge of this doorway. So if this is the doorway, then right here is like a shelf ledge, and then up here is the vertical surface leading up to this sort of platform here. So this platform area is a plane. Then there's a vertical surface going down facing this guide, but then it goes out a little bit. See how it's going out from here? It's kind of like a mantle going out from the wall. And I dropped a guide there. So this guide is in front. So this is the furthest most guide. This guide is now behind it. And this guide is the furthest most back to this platform. And this point of intersection right here that you're seeing that's vertical is basically just where the platform disappears into the bottom of the page, which is a great point to drop a vertical plumb line, right? So with that in mind, if we zoom way the freaking hell out, we can look at these three lines that are slowly disappearing. Whoa, that didn't go where I wanted it to go. There we go. There we go. These three lines are slowly disappearing into each other. Now this canvas is like, God, how big did I make this thing? More than 120 inches, yeah. This is 108 inches out from the left-hand side or however big that is. I don't even know. It's freaking huge. And look at this. It's still extrapolating outwards. I don't have enough space. Literally, the canvas for the digital computer, which is like pretty much an indefinite amount of space, it goes to the edge. I can't actually make these fully intersect because they go way the freaking hell out there. But they do at some point kind of intersect. You can see that there's two lines here. And then as you zoom in, you can kind of see, oh yeah, see they do two, these two do intersect. These two intersect actually. They do have a point of intersection somewhere. There is a point of intersection between these two lines. It's like somewhere around here, they disappear into each other, but they're still, if I turn the stroke off, or turn it down at least. There we go. If I turn it down, you can really get to the point where you see it. Yeah, it's like somewhere in here they intersect. So these two do intersect, and those are the top ones, the two topmost ones. And we'll go back into here so you can see them, and we're going to make them one point again. These two topmost ones do eventually intersect, but that's like way the hell out over here, like really far out somewhere in here. This guy, though, like he's still stretching outwards. So these two actually are crossing over each other by the time we reach. So they're intersecting and then twisting over each other. So you can ignore these two because conceptually they would end at some point. But here, this one continues pretty much onwards from it, nearly parallel to it. I mean, like, I think Dan's intention was to make that line as parallel as he could. And the thing is about this piece is it's from 1993, I believe, if I remember correctly. So it's one of Dan's early pieces. He did, what was it, Altars of Madness in 87. So it's like the first like 6 years of his career he's done this piece. So it's still very early in his career and he's still mastering perspective, but he has a very good understanding of it. But there is eventually a point of intersection where this plane and this plane will meet, and eventually this one, but you have to go far enough out to recognize it. I would say this is the foremost three-point perspective line. It's somewhere between this point right here going vertical, and then this corner right here. I think you could actually argue that it's probably directly on this corner like that. However, I chose this line because personally, because this is where the page ends and it's very close to this, I would say that this is an easier one to point out because you can really see where the red ends. I wouldn't call it this one because it's too far off of the focal point, which is, again, somewhere in here. That's why I think it's interesting because really, like, I would say the focal point of this piece is somewhere around his ankles and feet. And then as you migrate upwards, you get further away from it. But I really do think the focal point of the perspective is here. And the other reason for that is this bridge. So we have the topmost plane of the bridge. So you can see there's kind of a gap between this white line and this black edge. That's because actually there's an additional diagonal step here and an additional diagonal step right here from the actual platform. So there's this centerpiece, which I've boxed in here and here. There's this green part and this green triangle and then the white triangle going through it. And that's the highest part of the platform of the bridge. And then you've got this weird tooth-like shape over here and here. It's symmetrical in their placement. And that represents a step downward. So it's like a step up and then a platform. And this is sort of that center platform. And I used this topmost part because it was the most obvious set of parallel lines to create my topmost plane. However, you can see between this line and clearly this one, and I'll zoom in so you can very, very obviously see it. There's pretty much a straight line going through here. And you can now see from here to here, wrong tool, from here to here, there's like a diagonal and you can see me kind of build it like so. And I would say it actually probably goes in a little bit more than that. See, my line just disappeared because the freaking thing, it bugs out. See, I zoom in and now it disappears. My computer doesn't have enough RAM to really process this many lines, and I think it freaks my computer out sometimes. I think that's a little bit more inward. But basically, this line right here, and I'm going to make this one green. Just give me a second. This green line is sort of the step down, and then there's one also here, and it's stepping down and below the white line. So there's also a green line somewhere like so. So something like that. There's something there, roughly, I would say. This is a 599 pixel by 600 pixel picture, so there's only so much resolution to it. You can see that the one pixel got cut off there, that it's not actually perfectly square. This is the best version that I could find online. So I can only zoom so far. So a lot of this is guesswork. In his other piece, I could zoom in much more than 400% and get still a crisp image and be able to analyze what Dan was doing. So let's now look at some other parts of it. We've seen that this is basically the topmost plane. I'm going to delete these two guys right here because I don't want them cluttering up my drawing. We can see that my analysis of the drawing. What we can see here is this topmost plane, though, that is passing through. It's going through his ankles. So this floor needs to be parallel to the ceiling in this area because they're so close to each other in approximation that they really do need to look like they're perfectly parallel. But actually, they are skewed from each other. They float on top of each other, but if you look at my bottom hand, it's like... Or actually, let me do it like this. Go over here. You can kind of see that they're both on top of each other. You can kind of see that they're parallel to each other. But then, you know, this hand actually comes down a little bit, and they eventually vanish into the distance. And it's again because of the curve of the Earth. But up close, where you're looking at it, it looks like they're parallel to each other. It's only from a very far distance that you will see them disappear into each other going back. And that's this crazy way off into the distance left point. So here, we're really looking at everything in close approximation. So everything here should look parallel, which is why this area is a point of tension, because everything geometrically aligns around his ankles. That's why I said the focal point is probably somewhere around here, because he's done a lot of geometricism down here to line everything up. But there's also geometricism going through this the back of his chair, going through the front stand of his chair. Each of these little plinths that are diagonals off feeding into this straight line here, and then the forward ones. There's a rectangle here representing this right around here. There's roughly a corner, and I can assume that by just kind of doing this, rotating it by 45 degrees. Not quite 45 degrees. It's a little bit off from 45 because Dan has a very like skewed sense of perspective. I'm gonna kind of do it like that. Let's say it's something like that, and it's going to go to here. This is going to go out a little bit more. Now I'm going to grab this point and move it to there. Grab this point and go to about there with it. That looks like it's the end of the chair. I'm going to erase that point, and I would say it's going to... disappear off into some great far distance. But that's roughly what looks to be the this is the bottom edge of it right here. I'm trying to be really specific to capture it. Again, like he's eyeballing, I think, a lot of this to kind of like create it, but you would get a vanishing point going way off into the distance. But roughly this would be parallel to this set over here that's highlighted now in blue because I'm mousing over it. So these would be roughly parallel to each other because they're so close in approximation. If they weren't parallel to each other, it would look wrong. That's why there's so much focus there. And on this character, it's really the focus is around his legs, which is interesting. You would think it's his face or his chest, but it's really his legs. The reason why I kind of said it's not his face and it's somewhere in his chest is because his chest is in between his legs and his head, and his head is the furthest most part from the center of focus here, but the head is a point of focus because we always go to a face to examine the face because that's what we look to see in things is the face. So I've kind of like picked a neutral center point and said, well, it's this chest area, like I said in the beginning, because it's kind of in between this face, which is, you know, an inherent subconscious focal point, and this area of the legs and the box and the framing of his chair in comparison to this bridge, which is sort of like a geometric focal point. So that's like a really technical way of thinking about it, but let's look at some other things that kind of break it down. Well, for starters, we've got an archway right here. This is outlined in green. This archway represents the widest part of the bridge for the water to flow through. And conceptually speaking, it looks like it actually, this is a weird thing to explain, but it looks like the water gets wider at the mouth of the river. It's wider up here. It looks like it's narrowing downwards. Then in this midsection, it's opening up. And if the statue wasn't here, again, because in perspective, there are things in front of each other and things coming forward that are blocking the perspective of things behind, right? My hand is blocking my other hand. And my smaller hand is making a fist, but my other hand is blocking it because it's taller than it. But when I move it away, you can see the fist. So behind here, I believe there would be an opening that would be wider. And the reason I believe that is the way that this river is structured and the way everything is skewed in the perspective, it really does look like it's a wider area over here. And that's because this diagonal, which is going behind the statue, is opening outwards. It's opening outwards going this way. Instead of narrowing into the bridge, it's opening outwards. So it's like it's funneling into this bridge area, and this area is actually the tiny part of the funnel. This middle section over here is wider, and then this section over here is narrower. So it's like the wide cone of a funnel up against the wide cone of a funnel, narrowing out and towards the end. So it's like from narrow to wide. So it's like the opposite of an hourglass. If you broke an hourglass in half and took the two wide ends, or like if you imagine two Hershey Kisses and you took the bottom halves and put them together and you had the little tips sticking out, that's kind of one tip here and this is here, and this is the widest area of the river just by looking at how this line is opening up and this line out here where the edge of the water is meeting the ground is also opening up. So that's just another thing that's happening in this piece. It looks like this is a plane of water that is higher than this part down here because this water is kind of flat and is parallel to the ground up here, which means this is an area that is a plane, and then this right here is swooping downwards and is moving down into the waterfall going basically off the page. So this is kind of like a plane, so you can assume that this area here is actually pretty calm, and then the crazy rapids start over here, and you can really tell because of the brush strokes that he uses here. Here there's very small detailed brush strokes, and here there's very wide soft brush strokes to imply a greater movement of the water. And it's really just the fact that this plane that the water is looking on is very flat. This is kind of like going back to the idea of pouring water onto a flat countertop. Here it's very flat. Here you can very obviously see that the water is moving because it's a huge change in plane. And again, over here, you're seeing a change in plane. That's why the water is misshapen, but here it's matching this. And you have these rocks here that are kind of hinting at that as well and keeping this in perspective. Because realistically speaking, this area over here has water going behind it. Behind this logo, there's more water going off in that distant direction. And for that to happen, there'd have to be kind of like a dam here, which there kind of is. There's a couple of rocks. It's not really a dam, but you'd really have to have a dam here because what would happen is, since the water is moving downwards, water always wants to move downwards, this area would actually be drained. like in terms of just the natural physics of water, this area would be drained and the water would just be pouring off the edge here. There wouldn't be any water in this site. It would be a dry kind of valley and there'd be a little bit of shore here, actually connecting this thing to this thing. But he wanted to make it full, so he kind of put this here. But he didn't want to draw a dam because then it implies that this area is cut off and he wanted the power of the river going through. So he put some rocks there. I think that's why he did that. Some other concepts. Well, for starters, this circle right here is framed between these two red lines. Why are these two red lines red? I made these red lines and they are disappearing into this horizon line here, which I kind of conceptually said was the three-point perspective. Basically, everything is disappearing roughly into that corner, and it is forming a triangle. And these two red lines, all of these red lines right here, any red line in this section, and then also this red line right here, show a divergence in the perspective. So again, we talked about Dan Seagrave warping perspective. Here he's warping perspective again, but here he's doing it because I personally think he doesn't know what he's doing. Here he's doing it and it's a mistake, but it's an innocuous mistake. It's not a mistake that I'm criticizing and saying, oh, ha ha ha, I caught you, wag my finger at you. It's more like a mistake like he was freehanding it here. And, you know, one of my favorite bands, the Deftones, Steve Carpenter. That's his name. I actually am not a huge fan of the Deftones. I'm a huge fan of Steve Carpenter because Steve Carpenter has a really interesting philosophy about the guitar. He was talking about mistakes while recording. I believe it was Koi No Yoken. It was the one that came out before Diamond Eyes, which I'm pretty sure was Koi No Yoken. I think it was that one. That's the one with Rosemary on it. Yeah. They were recording that record and he was doing an interview to promote it. And then he talked about making mistakes. And he said, you know, sometimes the best thing you do is you make a mistake while you're recording and it's something that you couldn't have done on purpose. And it's not something that you can replicate because it was a mistake and it was on the fly and it was in that one take. And that mistake has its own artistic merit and value because in and of itself, it's a moment where something happened. And unlike the rest of the song, which is scripted out and is set to have a certain flow and an order of events, that mistake was like a moment of spontaneity and just kind of like chaos inserting itself into the recording process. And it gives the song a new kind of dimension of life. Because of the chaos. Now, I'm going to make this clear. That's not how Steve said it. He had a much more simple and eloquent way of saying it, but that's to the effect of what he was saying. So chaos and making mistakes and it not being a bad thing. That's the point. So this area is a big old weird perspective mistake, but it's not a bad thing. It's not a bad thing. It's just a weird thing. It's just a weird thing. I just look at it, I'm like, this area is warped. Because if it was truly parallel, it's still in such close proximity to this bridge and to all this geometric tension that is occurring here. And like, not geometric tension, but geometric focus that's occurring here. For these lines to be warped, it's like Dan is at the point where he's blocked everything else out. He's probably mentally exhausted, has put in an obscene amount of hours on this stupid painting. And he's like, fuck it. This is where Dan said fuck it and he just freehanded it, and that's how I can tell, because that was a fuck it moment. And that's what makes me love art, because it makes me feel like I'm not alone when you know you've put in 400 hours into a project and you're like, fuck it, I've put in too much time, I'm done. And then you're like, I'm gonna freehand it. And it's funny because those moments are good and they're bad. They're good because they're learning moments and they make you better at improvising, but they're always bad because in the future you get better at improvising and you look back and you cringe a little bit because you look at your own work and you're like, ah, I improvised there and it was a little rough. But those are the moments that you need to make in your art, whether it's in music, writing, or actually painting, that actually gets your instinctual sense of perspective, or your instinctual sense of time, or your instinctual sense of tone of voice, that gets it more refined by making, you know, mistakes and saying fuck it. So that's what that is. That's a fuck it moment. Let's talk now about this big fat green line and wrap this video up, because it's going on to being 40 minutes. So this green line basically represents the furthest edge of the water into what I saw was an intersection point in the land. Again, going back to looking at this vertical line, which intersects with this stupid little corner bridge, if we scroll up, it actually very closely intersects with the edge of the water. Not exactly on it, but very, 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 very closely. So odds are he drew a vertical line and then he went around the vertical line because he wanted to not directly hint at it. And very closely intersecting it is this kind of off-green line, which is framing the center of this bridge and is opening outwards. And the opposite of that is these sets of white lines, which are framing the center of the bridge, this being the elevated platform. So, how did I find the center of it? That was really hard to do. And it took a hell of a lot of time to figure out. Not the clapping, snapping. I know how to clap and snap. why did it, you, I don't know if you guys saw that too, the stinking little red line that appeared there. I don't know if I'm losing my mind. Okay. So what I did was I first laid down this top line right here. Then I went into dynamic measure and I grabbed it from here to there. And it gave me that measurement, which I then divided in half, which coincidentally is roughly where it placed the arrow, which is the thing I like the most about dynamic measure, is that it basically places the line on the centermost mark. That's got to basically be it. Oh, wait, no. It's not an active point. Something else is going on there. Yeah, that's a different anchor point. I moved that because I thought that it was offering me an anchor point there, but that's an anchor point from a different line, so I want to ignore that anchor point. I divided that in half, and roughly what I found was the distance, which is where this point is to here, is half of that. So if I clear all... Jesus Christ. Come on, stop being buggy. If I go to here and then I go to here, that's roughly half. So very, very close to being exactly half. Not quite, but very close. So I found that this was the center line here. Obviously, this line is smaller, which means that this is a trapezoid. Again, that's a perspective thing because, come on, stop acting up. Because Dan knows that he's got vanishing points and he's making things disappear. So if we look at this triangle, it's basically creating a vanishing point into the center of the water here. It's like a little bit behind it, but this is the arc of the water where the waterfall is beginning. So there's an arc, the water is coming down. It's blowing outwards, like the edge of a bowl. And then it's going outwards and down. It's going down and out. It's curving out towards you. That's why this line is moving forwards, because it's moving forwards on the plane and it's bowing outwards. The point of tension is slightly behind the arc, not directly on it, because again, if you're directly on it, it's just too nail on the head. So you want to be like a little bit off of those lines. Again, if you want to create geometric focus, you put all the lines directly on top of each other and you put one place where all those lines stack on top of each other. So there's just an intense amount of geometric focus in one area. Then you look at that area because you see all the geometry aligning, and it makes sense that it's here because it's a seat. And a seat is a man-made object. It's square. It has geometric proportions that are all parallel to each other. However, this waterfall is a phenomenon in nature, and it's not perfectly geometrical. Now, I do appraise the value of sacred geometry, where you have like the internal spiral of a conch shell or something, where there's a certain sort of mathematical precision to that, but that's different from a waterfall that's occurring due to erosion and all these weird natural phenomena. And you want to make the waterfall look natural. You know, waterfalls don't look like the spiral of a conch shell. They aren't perfectly proportional. They have their own character to them. So while I do appreciate the concept of sacred geometry, it doesn't really occur here in this instance for the waterfall. But it does occur in other things, like I said. So that being acknowledged, I dropped this point down, which is basically like right on top of this guideline. The interesting thing about this guideline is it's basically a baseline for the Benediction logo, and it also happens to be a point of intersection between this basically furthestmost shore edge and basically the point where this piece of land intersects with this piece of land here, because you have two pieces of land, again, one hand blocking the other, but this time instead, they're like this. You can't see my pinky finger on my thumb hand. You can't see me lifting it and lowering it in the direct camera. You can see it in the side cam, but not the direct one. And so what you create is a point of intersection. And you can't see the distance between the two hands. And what's in between the two hands disappears behind the bigger hand, which is what this rock face is here. So the water is disappearing between the two, and this is basically the point of intersection between the two land masses visually, which basically makes that a visual focal point. If I make a plumb line that is going 90 degrees, basically straight out of here, going perfectly horizontal, it coincidentally went from that point all the way through here. Coincidental or purposeful? I think that's purposeful. Initially, when I dropped this line down, I tried creating a guess point between the intersection of this sort of E and B and this O and N, kind of where this N kind of connects here. This N looks like a K, to be honest with you. I think this is a bad character. It looks like a K, shouldn't look like a K, should look like an N. And I think it's because this middle stroke doesn't really look right. So, between this kind of K looking N and this O, somewhere right around here is where I initially placed it. And then I placed a second green line and they were almost dead on top of each other. And I wasn't even looking at this point over here where they intersect. I was just looking at the Benediction logo and trying to create a horizon line going through it, because I knew that this is parallel to the top of it. You wouldn't make the logo skewed. You'd make it parallel to the top corner. It just wouldn't look right if it was skewed that way or that way. It wouldn't look right. So I assumed that it was parallel, and I just by eyeballing it got really close to hitting that green line. So again, that's something that Dan Seagrave did on purpose. It's not an accident. And it happens to intersect with this point of tension here and here. This is a different kind of point of tension, though. This is a concave point of tension because there's negative space that's disappearing between two objects. This is a convex focal point of tension because it's an object wrapping around another object. The water is wrapping around the landmass. Here, the water is disappearing and it's creating a concavity because the water is disappearing behind something. So you can actually come out of a concavity into a convexity and it won't create too much tension, but if you go into a concavity, it'll look like you're creating two arrows, because you have an arrow going out, you have a line going through the middle bisecting that arrow, and then you have another concavity on the other side, and the concavity on the other side is being bisected, and now you basically have a line with an arrow on either end pointing in either direction. And that is weird geometricism, and it calls attention to itself, and you don't want to do that. So here he has a concavity, which is on this left-hand side, and a convexity, which is on the right-hand side. They don't really call attention to each other because they balance each other. And that happens to go directly through the Benediction logo, which is completely on purpose and not a coincidence. And that's just a design concept right there, just making the logo look square. The bridge right here, again, it basically bisects the gap between the river. It's It's another, you know, visual cue. Something's going on with this tower. This tower actually looks like it's in very good perspective compared to this area, which is ironic because this area is out of perspective, but this area is in perspective. So the reason why I said earlier I think this is a fuck it area is because I'm pretty sure he spent a hell of a lot of time designing the river here, a lot of time designing this area here, because there's just a ton of detail in this weird midsection. It's just the most important area. This bench, stone bench creature thing that's seated, this demonic sitting demon thing, is the main point of focus in the whole piece. There's a lot of detail here. There's a lot of detail in the area around it, in these buildings over here, in this water, and in this tower, which shows the water disappearing into the far off distance, which gives us a sense of perspective and scope going backwards. So I'm pretty sure he actually has a lot of focal points disappearing behind the tower, and the tower is obscuring those focal points by being bigger than those points and being in front of them. And then all of that gets done. I'm pretty sure Dan Seagrave spends a ton of time working on all of that, spends a bunch of time building this spiral staircase and making it actually look very accurate. And he gets all that done, and then he's got this little section that hasn't been painted yet, and he's like, fuck it. And he just throws something in there and just very quickly puts it together. And that's kind of how I would look at it, because, again, if this was truly in perspective, this line out here wouldn't be ahead of this line. This line, which is basically the topmost edge and is closest to us, it's sloped. It's like this is the curved edge, and then where my hand, the top of my hand, is the part you would be walking on. You don't make sloped platforms. You make parallel platforms that are plumb. So, like, it could be slanted like a hillside, but this is obviously carved. That's how he's drawn it, to make it look like it was carved out of rock. So you wouldn't carve it at a slope. That doesn't make sense. So unless that side of the mountain is literally eroding and collapsing downwards, which you probably wouldn't include in a drawing because that's a very obscure concept to use to justify your perspective, I would say that it's, again, a fuck it. And I think he just threw this temple thing in here very quickly. These pathways are odd and kind of out of perspective. This one looks like it's okay, but this thing is weird. This thing right here, this line, I don't even know what this is. This temple face is obviously not in the same perspective as this. This line right here is skewed from this one. They're not the back stone bench, the back of the stone bench. This line right here, which is also part of the temple, is skewed from this, which tells me that this is not very well lined up to this. Again, it's not a bad thing. It's just understanding perspective. And when you spend, you know, now I have spent 3 hours analyzing the geometry of this piece. When you spend time looking at it in this manner, you just inherently see these things in the art. And again, it's not bad. I really want to make that clear. Like, Dan Seagrave is an amazing artist. I'm analyzing this because I admire his work. If I didn't admire his work, I wouldn't put in the time to break it down the way I am. I really respect this guy, but he's got some weird snafus in his perspective. It's not a bad thing. It just shows you that the way he thinks about it is just weird and different. And he's trying very hard to use very mathematically accurate geometric perspective to create something that's actually, like, from a Renaissance perspective, tradition, like, very accurate, like very, very mathematically accurate from a Renaissance tradition, which is a very difficult thing to do. Like, Dan Seagrave is, like, touching that ancient Renaissance tradition of, like, freaking Leonardo and Michelangelo and Titan and, like, you know, even John Singer Sargent and, like, all of the old masters. He's, like, touching that. And, like, he's a modern dude. He's a guy who's, like, touching a 600-year-old tradition going back to the 1400s. Because when you when you take the time to mathematically appraise your perspective and to really design your perspective and proportions, even if you don't have a mastery of figure drawing, if you have an appraisal of perspective, you basically are touching into the Renaissance concepts. I really, like, this is my personal belief. I really believe that there's a movement of modern Renaissance artists that are alive today that are trying to create a new Renaissance, and they're purists, and I think that they're very strident in their beliefs that everything needs to be about figure drawing and needs to be very, very, very mathematically accurate, but also like to the tradition of figure drawing in the old Italian Renaissance school, the old sort of what is it called? Atelier style of teaching, and or Altier, I don't know how you would pronounce it. And I definitely appreciate their sense of perspective and proportion and their understanding of tone, but I don't necessarily agree with all of their concepts of figure drawing. I really do think that there's a certain amount of creativity involved in being an artist today, and if you're just repeating the old tropes that are like freaking 500-600 years old, you're just kind of rehashing something that was already done by, for example, Titan, and you're never going to be able to beat him because Titan is Titan, because he was an original unto himself. So if you want to, you know, stand shoulder to shoulder with a guy like that, you have to do something original. You have to make your own Transcend the Rubicon, and you have to make your own piece of art. You have to have your own style. But you do have to acknowledge the technical aspect of drawing, which is perspective and proportion and color treatment. And, you know, you can tell that Dan has an understanding of tone. The chest, which is this recessed area, is darker than the arms, which are obviously getting more sunlight. He has a pretty good understanding of placement of shadows, even though his perspective is off. Because his perspective is off in certain areas, his shadows, his appraisal of shadows is also somewhat wrong. But where the shadows are geometrically correct, it's because the perspective is correct. Like in this tower area, the shadows here are incredibly sophisticated on each of these stairs. That's a very, very difficult thing to do, make these stairs and make them look actually like stairs, like you could climb them, like those stairs are real. That's a place that exists, and that's like a physically possible construction in real 3D space. This whole section, this whole middle section, looks like it could actually exist for the most part. There's some weird tweaks, but for the most part, this middle section, this bridge, this stone figure, these buildings over here, the staircase, the platform down here, the water, this weird stone quasi-dam thing that I explained earlier, this tower back here, the river over here, looks like it could actually exist. And that's because Dan acknowledges the Renaissance tradition. He actually acknowledges it. He has an understanding of it. Again, he's not figure drawing, but he is using proportion. He's using scale. He's using value, very, very sophisticated manner. So I think really like the idea that, you know, the only true form of Renaissance art is human figure drawing is a flawed concept. I think that if you, again, use the three main principles, that being perspective, proportion, and value, and you really work on mastering those three artistic perspectives, you are putting yourself in the Renaissance tradition. And, you know, maybe it takes you 20, 30 years, but if you're like Dan Seagrave and you start in, what, 85, 87, and you work your way until, you know, 2019, 2020, and you've been going on for, you know, 30 years, you know, you belong in the same canon, in my opinion, as the guys like Titan and stuff, because you're a master, you're an old master. Like, yeah, you're not figure drawing, but that doesn't really matter. You know, fuck it. That doesn't really matter. What matters is your ability to really understand the more intrinsic concepts. In fact, I think this is in some ways more creative than just rehashing old figure drawing, because he's creating a world that doesn't actually exist. It's imaginative. It's imaginative creativity. It's imagining what doesn't exist and bringing it to life, which I think is harder than conceptualizing what does exist and then translating that onto the page. Translating what exists onto the page is definitely a good technical skill, and you should practice it because it will make you better at your work. But the reality is that's not where your art should end, and that shouldn't be the focus of your art. What should be the focus of your art is improving. And obviously, this is a piece from 1993, and Dan has definitely improved since making this piece. So, I don't know. I really admire his work, like, really admire Dan Seagrave's work. He's definitely one of my favorite artists. I've now moved on to another project in my own sort of art portfolio, where I'm now kind of exploring my Rick Griffin influence. And Rick Griffin is like completely the opposite of Dan Seagrave. He's like bright, happy paintings. He's a born again Christian. He's like, this is total opposite. Total opposite. I'll give you an example. Total opposite. This is the album art for Mustard Seed Faith. Just open it in Photos. What the hell, computer? Oh, I hate this computer. I need to get a new computer. I'm so broke. I just need to save $1,500, but I am just broke. Oh, my life. My life. Come on, come on. Jeez, Photos, come on. Oh, you're killing me. All right, here we go. Mustard Seed Faith. So we have Transcend the Rubicon, death metal album by Dan Seagrave. Let me just zoom out a little bit and just move this over. Transcend the Rubicon, and then we have Mustard Seed Faith. What I like about this is the colors. Obviously, the water is incredibly beautiful, in my opinion. And I love the black silhouette frame and the way some of the clouds come in front of it. And the water obviously comes in front of it. This is Rick Griffin. He's the guy who invented surf art. So all the old surfer comics from the 1960s, he was the guy who came up with it. And I just really love his warm palette. It's really beautiful. And this is another guy who, in my opinion, is, you know, on par with the old masters, because he's doing the same thing Dan Seagrave is doing. He's doing everything in perspective. The entire ship is in perspective to itself. There's some vanishing point in front of the ship that everything is disappearing into, because obviously the back of the ship is wider than the front. So everything that's in the back of the ship is disappearing into the front. The sails are the only exception to that, because the sails are wider, but then they bow inwards because, you know, they're catching the wind. And then, so the sails are like sheets. They're bowing outwards, they're billowing outwards, and then they're pulling forwards and they're bowing upwards. But you can see that the tension is more focused on the bottom. That's where this really dark orange hue is, and then lighter on the top. And you can tell that this is the area of the sail that is catching the most amount of wind, and it's a really good point of tension in the piece. And obviously he scales it up on the next sail and the next sail, and then these ones that are even further in front. And then he's got the back sail, which is used for steering the ship. So these ones are catching momentum and driving it forward, but then this one, this foil sail, is used for catching the wind at an angle and then directing the ship in addition to the rudder. So it's just a really beautiful piece. Like, this is like very serene and gorgeous, and this is just gnarly as freaking hell, but this is really awesome as well, you know. And I love both of them because they're both very good pieces, because they both follow those same three rules. They're both in perspective, they both respect value, and they both have a good sense of scale. When scale relating to perspective, that is. But still something that should be respected in its own right. And that's the thing. Like, I really really love art. I really love art, like irregardless of the style and of the artist. If something is good, I'll look at it and I'll know that it's good and I will admire it. I won't, you know, pick one over the other. I'm not just, you know, a genre-centric focused artist where it's like, oh, only death metal. You know, I really like all kinds of styles and stuff. And the next thing that I'm exploring is Rick Griffin stuff because it's kind of like a break from all the heavy metal, a very necessary break from all of that. And it's in a different direction. It's very refreshing and peaceful and idyllic. I really love this painting. This is an amazing Rick Griffin piece. The Oxa Moaxa cover. Here we go. Let's see if it'll load. Will it load? Yes, open with photos. This is a GIF? Why is it a GIF? Nothing should be moving. I don't understand. This should be a JPEG. So this is Oxa Moaxa. very different from Dan Seagrave. Also an album cover. this is actually a little bit closer to my art style. My art style is very graphic and more flat, and I'm trying to break out of that. That's why I was looking at Dan Seagrave and Roger Dean. But for a very long time, I've looked at a lot more flat graphic styles, more akin to Rick Griffin and his early work. But again, Mustard Seed Faith, which he put this out after he became a born-again Christian. I'm pretty sure this is the story, the unofficial story that I know about Rick Griffin, is he was hanging out with the dead and back in the 60s, and a bunch of people were burning out on drugs and fucking up their lives. So he became a born-again Christian and for the most part was trying to rebuild his life so he could actually do art and actually have a life and not just be a screwed up hippie, burnt out on drugs. And for the most part, I think Rick really saw in that a sense of purpose for himself. And he sobered up. It was really tragic because he died in a motorcycle accident back in 91. He was driving his motorcycle and some guy made a left turn while he was driving his bike and just ran him right over and killed him. But there's definitely a freshness to his work. You know, Oxa Moaxa is great. Don't get me wrong. Like, my next project is really focusing on making my own version of this font. And I'm really heavily inspired by Rick Griffin's work. Obviously, this is a dickhead skull. This is an egg, and these are sperm. And those are the testicles of the dickhead skull. And that's a little bit of cum right there. Everything in this piece is so bizarre and psychedelic, and I love it. that's Rick Griffin. But here, there's more of a story. One of the things I really like about this piece is that you can see in the background there's a stairway and what looks to be a city in the clouds. And if you look at the wave, it's a very unnatural wave. That's not actually how waves form, because if a wave formed like that, it would automatically collapse under itself. But this wave looks like it's lifting the boat out of the water and into the clouds, and it looks like the boat is actually sailing into the clouds and the kingdom of heaven is in the clouds. And regardless of whether you're a Christian or not, just the mythology behind this piece and the symbolism of being uplifted into the stairway to heaven is in itself like a very wonderful narrative, which is also part of the Renaissance tradition, is that you always have some kind of narrative in your piece, that it tells a story. It's not just a flat piece of artwork, but that there's a story. Like for me in the Transcend the Rubicon, it's like I'm assuming that this stone statue is like some kind of deity and the people here worship it. And I don't know what else it is, but it's like some kind of creature, and it's a very ominous looking place, and there's no people in the streets, but it's like obviously this place was built, and there's light coming from this area down here, so there's obviously still people here. There's probably torches in there burning to create that red light, so there's still people living and inhabiting this area, but it looks very ancient and mostly abandoned. you know, there's no light over here on this side, but there is down here. So it's like there's still people living in this area, but there's very few of them. And they are still somehow in this weird demonic deity's influence. They're under the influence of this creature. And, you know, maybe the people living here are also demons, or maybe they're actually just people. Maybe the demon is kind to these people because they're devil cultists. Maybe he's an oppressive deity. Who knows? But there's like what is this ancient creature? What is this place? Where is this place? There's like instead of telling a story like a narrative, it's asking a bunch of questions, but those questions in a sense serve the purpose of a narrative. There's more to it than just a flat piece of art. In the Oxymoaxa piece, there's kind of a narrative here. It's not as sophisticated. It's more of like a visual gag, but it's still there to give the piece greater depth. It's like, when you initially look at this, you think this is just the sun and this is just a skull holding two stones. But then you kind of realize like, oh, those are testicles and that's the head of a penis and that's sperm on an egg. And then you see the fetuses off to the side, and then it's like, oh, this is about conception and creation. And there's some other things in here, like there's the shapes in here, which is an A and an M for like Oxymoaxa. So there's like an A, an M, and then the two crossed bones obviously form an X. So A-O-X-O-M-O-X-O-A. So like he's kind of spelt it here. Legs of this weird beetle creature are just perfectly symmetrical, but they kind of look like an M to me. And, it's just a very visually symmetrical piece, and there's a visual gag, whether you can, you know, on first glance catch that it's about conception and procreation. And there's a lot of little graphic elements here that are unique, but it doesn't necessarily tell a story, but there is a lot of substance to it. And that's why it captures the viewer's eye. You see it and your eyes are rested because there's a lot going on, but there's not really a story. It's more of a visual gag. This asks questions which hints that there's a story behind it, but you don't know what the story is. The story is shrouded in mystery, and this piece is quite literally a story. It is a boat rising out of the waves into the kingdom of heaven. And that's like a very literal story. And you can really see it. That's why I really admire Rick Griffin, because throughout his career, he did some really amazing stuff. And when he became a born again Christian, instead of like selling out and becoming like a religious psychopath, he still really kept to his roots of creating art. He didn't really preach. His whole idea was to just, you know, make art and let the art speak for itself. He didn't really go around telling people, you know, how it is they should live their life. He just tried to make art that was really inspiring. And that's why I kind of admire him, because he's not one of those pontificating born-again Christians. He was just one of those guys who lived a really rough early life, hanging out in the whole, like, deadhead scene where people were burning out on acid and heroin. And he got away from it, and he wanted to just live a better life and be a more fulfilled and, you know, just wholesome person. That's kind of who Rick Griffin was. That's why I really admire him. He was the hippie surfer guru without the drugs, for the most part, on the later half of his career. I'm pretty sure he smoked pot until he died, but from what I've read about him in his later career, he pretty much reformed away from drug use just because he saw so many people burn out on it, which is something I admire, because the 60s was a really hedonistic era, and a lot of people from that era had potential, but they just threw it away being arrogant. And Rick was really trying to make stuff, and he just really tragically died young. And, you know, I really feel like he could have made way more stuff. Like, if Rick Griffin was still alive, man, we'd have so much more stuff from him. And he's such an amazing artist. That's why I'm really glad that we still got Dan Seagrave making crazy demonic shit. See, you gotta have the dichotomy. You gotta have both sides of it. So, that video, as of this recording, is an hour and 13 minutes. I really don't think I'm going to spend any time editing this. I'm just going to slap the audio into a Premiere file and just upload this because, man, I recorded a 2-hour version of this already and did a bunch of preparation work and that video got lost. So, you know, this is a little bit more raw, but it's still more focused than the last video. And hang on. So shout out to Miguel Galindo. Miguel hit me up and you know, I responded to his request. So if you're interested in me doing a video, if you're interested in me, you know, explaining something to you about art or about music, you know, hit me up and I will respond to you. I will make a point of getting back to you and making, you know, a video. It will probably take me some time. I recorded the video last week, but like I said, there were a lot of problems with it, so I'm redoing it. But, you know, he sent me a message January 19th. And it's a little bit over a month and I'm getting back to him. Technically, it would have been sooner, but I will get back to you if you reach out to me. I guarantee you, if you reach out to me, I will get back to you. It may take me some time, but I guarantee you, I always have the intention of reaching out to you if you take the time to reach out to me, because I want to talk to you. I want you to engage with what I'm doing and I want to engage with you back. So, yeah, signing off now, hour and 15 minutes, 30 odd seconds. I'm Keenan Fry. This is the Acid Drip. Thanks for watching and stay cool. Stay sexy, motherfuckers. I'm probably going to have to edit that last part out.